things he's worked on, and it's amazingly rich body of work that he's done, but also it fits into a lot of other work that's done at this and other universities. And therefore, we're particularly happy to have him here today. It involves trade, technology, the organization of the firm, the flow of ideas and physical objects within the firm internationally. And he calls his talk today the changing nature of global integration. So welcome, Aseem. Great to have you here.
I'm going to stand to introduce me, or can I just talk to you?
I think sure, that's how you adjust it.
So thanks, and thank you for having me present here. It's a great opportunity. I wanted to say a couple of preparatory things before I jump into the talk itself. First off, of course, this is joint work with Heather Berry, who is now at the George Washington University. And Heather and I have been working, we're both basically strategy people, but we've been working a lot on thinking about how knowledge and technology affects firms' international decisions. So we're really thinking about, you know, this idea of knowledge seeking and firms going abroad to tap into foreign expertise and foreign knowledge is sort of a large part of much of our work. And frankly, most of our work is actually much more at the firm level, so we're really interested in firm decisions. But this one piece is a lot sort of broader. It's about integration, pressures for integration at the industry level, which is why I thought it would be a good fit for this context, because what we're really interested in studying, as I talk about, is sort of this phenomenon of how the flows of goods between countries is shifting within the firm. And so we want to kind of talk about, and I think that has important implications for public policy, that has implications for trade and macroeconomics. And so that's what I'm going to be talking about today. I want to start by just talking about the title. So what do we mean when we say changing nature of global integration? First off, what do we mean by global integration? So we're going to define global integration as the extent to which resources are shared across national borders within the firm. So think about it as within the multinational, to what extent is there sharing between the different divisions of the multinational between countries. And there are many different kinds of resources that you might think about. You might think about the flow of knowledge. You might think about the flow of personnel. We're going to be focused for this research piece on product flow, so the flow of goods between the different divisions of the multinational. And that's a set of flows that a lot of people have thought about, in particular because that's obviously the one that maps closest to trade. So most people end up thinking about product flows. So that's going to be our focus. And we're going to really sort of base this off work by Steve Coburn, who we were just talking about. So Steve, in 1991, published this paper which looked at kind of the factors that drive integration. And in that 91 piece, he basically does two things. First, he defines a measure of global integration, which has since been used by a number of people. This paper is widely cited. And he defines this thing called the Coburn Index, which is simply the intra-firm cross-border product flow, so the flows of goods within the firm across national borders, divided by the foreign sales. And the denominator is there basically to sort of scale out the effect of how international you are. So obviously, the more international you are, the more flows there are going to be between countries, but that's not what we're really thinking about. Given a certain level of internationalization, how integrated are the businesses between countries? And so Steve, having defined this index, uses 1989 data from the Bureau of Economic Analysis, which is also going to be our source, and he does this cross-sectional analysis of, you know, which industries tend to be more integrated. And what he finds is that it's the high-tech industries that tend to have the highest level of integration, and the rationale for that is basically that as you become more high-tech, the need for a global scale. So if you're spending on R&D, you're spending on technology, the need you have to be kind of a global player and to be integrated in all your operations and selling basically the same product tends to be higher, which is why high-tech industries tend to have more integration. Richard?
Clarification question. Is the product flow a finished product or half-finished product?
It could be either. So it's the BA doesn't actually distinguish between intermediate flows and finished goods.
Okay.
So it's just there is some flow happening within the firm. And it's kind of hard. We can, and empirically, we try to control a little bit for how much of this is intermediate, but since the BA doesn't have the data, we can't. So that really is sort of where Steve left it, which was saying high-tech industries in the cross-section tend to be more integrated. What we want to do is start from that point and take it, think about what's really happened since 1989, right? So the first thing is, what's one thing that's happened since 1989, and we take it up to 2004, which is kind of the last date that we had benchmark survey data for. One, there's been a fairly substantial increase in the levels of global integration over that time. So what this chart shows you is basically for all US manufacturing, so manufacturing industries, SIC codes 2000 to 3999, all US manufacturing, this is the Coburn Index in 1989 versus 2004, again based on the BA data. So the 20% integration that you see is where what Steve had. And we can see there's been a fairly substantial increase from about 20% to about 28% in the period of 15 years. So firms have been becoming much more integrated. And I want to emphasize that this is as a percentage of foreign sales. And foreign sales have grown fairly dramatically over this period as well. So actually, the amount of flows has gone up much more than this would suggest. But we're sort of netting that up.
Aseem, first, do you want any questions as we go along?
Yeah, okay. Absolutely.
All right. So then the question, and this may be, this is subsidiary, part of the pun. But to what extent do you think Coburn's index and or your variations on it captures integration that is global, meaning around the world, versus, say, integration of a regional sort? As you know, in international business literature, there's this kind of running gun battle about whether multinationals are truly global or whether they're just regional.
And we will try to look at that. So let me go a little bit further and then come back to your question. So one of the things we've tried to look at is affiliate-to-affiliate transfers. Now, that still doesn't get you to region, but certainly if a subsidiary is sending to another subsidiary and the U.S. is just not involved, that may be the closest proxy we can get to region, and we'll sort of talk about that. But, that's all built into this at this point. Yes.
Just to expand that question, and I regret, I think I missed your first few sentences, but I think your focus is only on those firms that are transferring between units or between subsidiaries.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So this is all intra-firm trade. So this is all within the firm across borders, although it's aggregated up to all firms in the industry, right? So it's all the flows that are happening within the firm across national borders.
I see, and that's
anything that's being sold outside.
Both of your charges.
Yeah, both of those charges, right? So one, there's been a big increase in this number, but I think the more interesting thing when we start to look at the data is there's actually a major shift in the direction in which those transfers are going, right? So what we've done in this chart, this is the same overall number. All we've done is we've broken out the transfers from the parent, so the transfers from the U.S. headquarters or from the U.S. operations to subsidiaries in other countries. So that's the light blue numbers at the bottom, transfers from parent, and separated those out from the flows from the subsidiaries either back to the U.S. parent or to other subsidiaries in the system, right? And we can break that out further to your question, Paul. We could. About two-thirds of these numbers tend to be flows back to the parent, and the remaining one-third tend to be flows to other subsidiaries, right? So, but the trend is pretty much the same for both of those. They've both grown fairly substantially. So we don't really do too much with that, although as a robustness check, we break that out. So what you can see here is that as a percentage of foreign sales, flows from the U.S. parent to subsidiaries have stayed pretty much stagnant. They've actually declined. So this is the compound annual growth rate. There's a marginal decline, but this is basically a flat picture, right? So the U.S. subsidiary is not, the U.S. headquarters is not sending a lot more goods to the subsidiaries. All of this increase in integration is happening as a result of the subsidiaries doing a lot more in terms of sending products both back to the U.S. headquarters as well as to other subsidiaries. So it's really transfers from affiliates that have grown very, very dramatically. I mean, essentially, transfers from affiliates have basically doubled in this 15-year period, and that's a really substantial change. As a result of which, in 1989, about two-thirds of all transfers within the firm were transfers from the corporate headquarters to other units outside the country. By 2004, that number is 40%, right? So in 2004, the majority of transfers within the firm are actually originating outside the US and are going to either coming back to the U.S. or going to other affiliates in other countries. So we think that's a very substantial change. And of course, these numbers are all sort of aggregating all manufacturing industries together. We can then break it up by industry, and in order to keep this legible, I've taken off the labels of the industries. But what this chart shows is basically how much of the transfers from the parent grown by industry, so what's the distribution across industries, as well as how much the transfers from affiliates have grown. And as you can see, for 31 of the 33 industries that we're tracking, there's basically been an increase in the transfers from affiliates. So again, consistent with that picture, transfers from affiliates, the role of the subsidiary has changed, has grown pretty much in all the industries, though there's a fair amount of range. I mean, on the upside, on the higher side, there's about a 15% year-on-year growth. In the lower end, there's about a 1% or a 0.5% year. So those are big differences. The one industry where transfers from affiliates have sort of substantially declined is beverages, and I honestly don't have a good explanation for that. This seems to be an outlier. But also you can see in this figure that transfers from parents, we said, have been flat overall, but that sort of flat picture actually hides a lot of differences by industry, where some industries have seen a dramatic decline in how much parents are actually sending to subsidiaries. Other industries have seen fairly substantial increases, in some cases actually higher increases than the increase in affiliates as a result of over this time period. So the overall picture here is that there is an overall trend of transfers from affiliates becoming more important, but there's also, you know, a lot of heterogeneity by industry in terms of, you know, which direction these things are shifting. Paul?
I see that, just a clarification, is are the industries defined, I assume, by the SIC or NAID codes? And so what digit are they defined?
These are three-digit SIC codes,
okay.
Which is the which is what VA collects. So,
so yeah. it's pretty aggregate.
It's pretty accurate. It's very accurate.
So is the beverage data point because beverages are largely water and there may be economies of scale?
I think that's true. I also think some of it is driven by the fact that, over this time period, a lot of the big beverage companies have started to set up operations locally. So
right.
So you're getting away
yeah.
from,
yeah.
right? So that's so. I don't think it's just water. I think that's also true for some of the Coke, Pepsi. Because
no, I meant that they're all, there's a lot of bulk.
Yeah,
you
absolutely right. So that's a lot of stuff. Right. Yeah.
What's going to these transfers back to the U.S.? Is that back to the U.S.?
Right. So the transfers.
You're assuming the parent is always in the U.S.
Yeah. So these are only U.S. multinationals. So the parent is by definition. It's not an assumption. That's the.
Maybe you're anticipating something, but the are they coming back for additional processing, or are they going to the retail, going to the consumers?
They're not going to the consumers because they are being sent back to the parent. So again, it's within the firm, but we don't. And as I mentioned earlier, we're not able to distinguish between intermediate products and final products.
Yeah,
so they could be final products that are then going to, you know, go back to the corporate headquarters and then get pushed out to the retailers.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not being sold to a third party directly.
Yeah, an example would be like Boeing aircraft. Boeing has parts made all over the world now, and they send them all back to Seattle to assemble the airplanes.
Right, and so
and that a lot of that's political, because to sell airplanes to certain countries, you gotta have the manufacture part. So there's a lot of politics in what's going on between this trade transfer stuff and why they're
That's true. But you picked an extreme example. I mean, aircraft really is extremely political, relatively.
Yeah, but anyway, aircraft would be an example.
But another, I mean, Apple computers, they're assembled in Taiwan. Then they're shipped back here to Apple, and then for
so absolutely. So this would include both of those things, right? So both the model where you basically made pretty much a finished product, you're shipping it back, and then the company is selling it, and it would include the more intermediate sort of, we made a component, we shipped it back to you, and then you assembled it. We are going to try, empirically, to try to sort of control for what's the extent to which there's intermediation. But as far as the arguments and the theory goes, we're not really going to separate out intermediate versus final product. I think in either case, it's really interesting that there is much more of this manufacturing and production is happening outside the country, and it's all coming back, and that's really what we're going to try to explain. So I'm not sure that the intermediate versus, I mean, obviously there is that difference, but I'm not sure that we're going to get into that too much.
Right.
Richard?
how do you define an affiliate? Does it have to be part owned by the firm? Because a lot of examples where the airplane or Apple, they are outsourced. I mean, they are not part
of
the firm.
So that's a good question.
That shouldn't be captured
in
the
data. I will talk more about that when I get to the data. The quick answer is these are affiliates here are majority owned subsidiaries. So you have to have more than 50% of the ownership stock. We also do have data on the extent to which there is offshore outsourcing. So you're buying from a third party. We do actually capture that, and we control for to what extent are you buying from a third party in other countries. But we're not going to, and I will also say that while it's technically it's majority owned subsidiaries, about 93 or 94% of it is wholly owned subsidiaries. So because, you know, once you're over 50%, a lot of these subsidiaries are wholly owned. I think the mean ownership is 95% or something. So we're really talking about subsidiaries.
Really,
we're not really talking about... So, you know, we think this is an important... I mean, we think these trends are really important for two sets of reasons. One, I think we think they're important organizationally, because what we're really saying is it's a completely different version of the multinational, right? So I think our old models of the multinational, we think of there being like this big corporate headquarters, and then they're, I mean, the very term subsidiary sort of suggests a subservient kind of position. But as many other people have mentioned in recent years, there's a growing role of subsidiaries. So a lot of Julian Birkinshaw's work, a lot of Cantwell's work, it's really about how subsidiaries are taking on a much greater role. And what we're seeing in this data is pretty much consistent with that, right? We're seeing a model where subsidiaries are not you know, a lower order of the hierarchy. They are really important firms that are doing a lot of the manufacturing, a lot of the R&D, etc. And so there's a changing nature of how we think about how MNCs are organized, how they're structured, how they operate. At the same time, these numbers are fairly important from a macroeconomic perspective, right? So depending on which source you look at and depending on which year you look at, intra-firm trade makes up something like a third of world trade, right? So if you think about the numbers I showed you, in terms of the shift from US manufacturing going outwards to stuff being manufactured elsewhere and coming back in, those numbers are only for trade within the firm, but trade within the firm is about 30% of our trade, which means that those numbers actually have fairly serious implications for the balance of trade and therefore the balance of payments and all of that stuff. But also, you know, a lot of people in the economics of trade manufacturing literature have talked about how one of the big trends that's kind of problematic, is, which is obviously affecting employment, is affecting, you know, value added in this country, is about this increasing role of production being moved offshore, right? Both through offshore outsourcing as well as through firms doing more of their manufacturing abroad. You know, so papers by Finstra, Borga and Zeal actually work on the same data set that we work on. That's a big trend, and that has obviously major implications for the economy. And that's all built into this notion of where the subsidiaries are actually working. And so we think this is a really important phenomenon. We think it's an important trend. And yet, you know, while many people have talked about the fact that the trend is happening, there hasn't been a lot of systematic analysis, especially in the sort of organizational literature, on what's actually driving this trend, right? So we have our sort of conventional wisdom explanation that it's all about low cost and we're all just moving to China or Mexico because it's cheaper to manufacture there. But what we want to do with this paper is really sort of say, is that really what's going on, or is that the primary driver of this trend? Can we systematically think about, you know, if we're seeing these trends and we're seeing differences in these trends by industry, what is really driving that? And so that's really our question. What drives this trend over time? We want to distinguish between, as I already suggested, given this kind of fact that there's a shift in the direction, we want to distinguish between flows from parents and flows from affiliates. And in robustness checks, we will distinguish between affiliate-to-affiliate flows and affiliate-to-parent flows, although I'm not going to necessarily show you those numbers today. We want to study the trend at the industry level. Again, that's partly just to be consistent with prior work. I mean, Steve's work and other people, a lot of the work in this field has been at the industry level. And also, if you sort of think about the pressure for integration conceptually, it's kind of an industry-level phenomenon. So we want to sort of stay at that level of analysis. And as I've already mentioned, we're going to focus on product flows. So we're not going to get into knowledge flows. Other people have looked at knowledge flows or personnel flows. We're going to focus on product flows, in part because that's what we've got data on, but in part because, you know, I think that's been the focus of a lot of the prior work. Let me talk very quickly, and I'm going to try and keep this somewhat brief because I do want to get to the data and the phenomena. Let me talk very briefly about what sort of the theoretical underpinnings of what we're trying to do here is, right? So the classic sort of traditional integration responsiveness framework, which is sort of the, you know, international business 101. So this is the stuff I teach my MBA students. Actually, I'm doing this next week. Is this idea that firms face kind of these two pressures, right? There is a pressure to be globally integrated, so have your operations integrated, and there's a pressure to be responsive to local needs and conditions. And those are two sort of, those are two dimensions, and then what strategy the firm picks, how you organize, how you compete, is based on which, you know, how strong those pressures are. So underlying, within that, basically, the pressure to be integrated, the need to be integrated is seen as being either high or low, right? So it's kind of a single construct. But as a number of people before us have sort of pointed out, in particular, some of Pankaj Himawat's more recent work, integration really kind of includes two different, very different aspects, right? So there's an aspect of integration which is all about aggregation, right? So we need to be, which is more sort of the story that I told you with that Steve is talking about, right? So the COVID paper is all about aggregation. The idea there is that you want to have economies of scale and scope. So let's say you've got a strong brand, you've got a strong technology or whatever, you've got a, the parent has a capability or a resource, you're going to spend a lot of money to keep that resource, develop that resource. You want to leverage that spend across as large a market as possible. So you want to be, have global scale. And that's really the notion of an aggregation benefit where you're just trying to get scale, you're trying to aggregate sales across all these different countries, right? The second type of benefit, and this terminology I should say goes back to, is Himawat's terminology that we're sort of adopting. The second kind of integration pressure is really the pressure for arbitrage. So arbitrage is this idea that you want to essentially get the best of all possible worlds, right? So you want to tap into whatever local resources are there, but leverage those resources across your entire global system. So if there's a place where there's low-cost production, you want to leverage production in that place for the rest of your global system. If there's a place where there's a lot of expertise in terms of technology or knowledge, you want to leverage that. And I talk a little bit more about that. So the benefits are basically you want to leverage local resources globally. That's a very different picture of integration than the aggregation. That's not about, it's not really about economies of scale. It's about tapping into the local resources wherever they are available. Once you accept that the pressure for integration sort of can be broken up into these two different aspects, and as I said, you know, this is not, a lot of other people have talked about this, you can then start to connect what kind of pressures firms face with the motives that are driving firms in an industry to go abroad, right? So here's a typology of kind of what are the different motives that drive firms to go abroad. There are some tweaks, I mean, you know, different authors have slightly different variants, but I think, so this one is actually taken from work by Bartlett and Ghoshal, but different people have sort of broken some of these out and integrated some of these. But the four big motives are you're either looking for markets, you're looking for low-cost imports or efficiencies, you're looking for basically low costs. You're looking for knowledge, or you're going abroad because you want to deal with competition. So your competitors are international, there's oligopolistic competition, you need to be international as well, okay? So those are the four big motives. When you think about what those motives means in terms of the kind of integration pressure that you're facing, or the benefits you're going to get from integration, the market-seeking motive really is about aggregation, right? So you have this great resource at your home country, you want to leverage that in as many markets as possible. So that's kind of the classic story that I just told you about aggregation. So market aggregation, and what that means in terms of how you think about the structure of the firm is you're going to see this kind of hub and spoke structure where you have a centralized firm, the corporate, it's also sort of centralized in the headquarters, and the flows are going to be mostly outward from the parent to the subsidiaries because we're trying to leverage these economies of scale and then push stuff out to the local markets. If you're doing it for low-cost labor imports, you're going to see that's an arbitrage benefit, right? You're trying to tap into local resources. The kind of structure that suggests is either, you know, if you're doing all of your manufacturing in one country, let's say you manufacture entirely in China or entirely in Mexico, then you're still going to see a hub and spoke, but the hub is now going to be the country where you're doing your manufacturing, right? So you're going to have a centralized structure in a subsidiary, with the subsidiary being the focus. Or if you're tapping into multiple different costs, so some cost is lower here, the cost for one component is lower somewhere, the cost for another component is lower somewhere else, you're going to get something that looks more like a network where there are flows in multiple directions. But again, a lot of it is going to be, you know, the affiliates basically doing a lot of the production and pushing out. Keep in mind that we're sort of implicitly assuming that we're talking about U.S. multinationals, so U.S. is not the low-cost production destination. Okay. So the implication of the cost-seeking is you're going to have, there's going to be cost-seeking arbitrage that's going to drive basically transfers from the affiliates. If you're doing it for knowledge, again, similar story, right? It's about arbitrage, so you're trying to tap into local knowledge. You're going to end up with a very network structure, and you're going to end up with an affiliate-driven transfers, right? So you're going to be transferring a lot, although again, you're going to be doing that. So again, you're going to have this structure, and you're going to have transfers from the affiliate. Finally, if you're doing it for competitive, if you're doing it for competitive motives, it depends on who you're competing against. You're competing against your home country competitors in foreign markets, that may drive you to be more parent-driven because so the idea is you want to be transferring from the same place that your competitors are transferring from, right? So if you're competing with your home country competitors in foreign markets, it's going to be parent-driven. To the extent that you're competing with foreign players, it's going to be more, you know, the subsidiaries are going to be doing a lot more of the production and transferring. So you end up with sort of a multilateral picture where it's both, if you're competing with both, you're going to have flows both ways, where some stuff you're going to be doing a lot more from the parent, some stuff you're going to be doing a lot more from the subsidiary, depending on who you're really competing against.
May I ask about that last category? That's the one that I find a bit puzzling. I mean, if the firm, I know that there are different models of the firm, but you take the simplest model of the firm, a profit maximization, sort of unitary actor, why is the last one not a fifth wheel? I mean, wouldn't you always be seeking, greater demand and lower cost everywhere?
You would, but I think the idea here is that, you want to, not only do you want to seek lowest cost, but you also want to seek parity with your competitors. And so to the extent that your competitors
you
are
want to
set up,
them.
You want to beat them, but in some ways, you're right that it's a fifth wheel in that I think the assumption is that if they are set up in a particular way, that is giving them some advantage over you, and so you want to achieve parity to make sure that any advantage they're getting from being in a particular location. So let's say you're dealing with foreign competition and you're competing with a bunch of companies, firms that are making, you are making all your stuff in, let's say, in the U.S., but you're competing with a bunch of players who are making stuff in Taiwan, right? So that's kind of the laptop, desktop industry. You want to have a presence in Taiwan, not only because that's a low-cost location, but also because that's where your competitors are. And so even though, you want to be in that location not just to tap into low cost, but also to tap into whatever they're doing, be aware of their strategy. So as they make changes in their
It's really a knowledge, ultimately a knowledge.
So it's actually
an information imperfection.
Yeah. So in some ways, it's basically a story about the same cost in knowledge seeking, but you can think about it as being amplified by the fact that you also want to achieve parity
right.
on your competitors and experts in
knowledge,
right? Okay. So with that, so this is just a quick slide that tells you what our hypotheses are going to be. So we're basically going to argue that market aggregation, sort of consistent with the slide I just showed you, market aggregation is going to drive parent transfers, which is basically the Cochrane story. Knowledge arbitrage is going to drive affiliate transfers. The one tweak there is that it also depends on whether knowledge is global, right? So there isn't a whole lot of need to try to tap into local knowledge and apply that if knowledge is very local. So if it's all about, so one reason you might want to tap into local knowledge is to customize things for local markets if the kind of technologies are very different in different markets. But if technologies are global, then you want to tap into the local expertise but apply it in other places. So you're only going to see integration if knowledge is global. If knowledge is not global and it's very sort of customized to different markets, you're not actually going to see integration at all. You're going to see basically just adaptation. Competitive arbitrage, again, going back to this notion of you want to be kind of have parity with your competitors. If you're competing with foreign competitors, you're going to have more sort of role for subsidiaries. If you're competing with home country competitors, you're going to have more role for parents. So depending on And of course, you could have both. So depending on which of those is going to be more important, you're going to see transfers either from the affiliate or the parent. And finally, cost arbitrage, we're saying low-cost pressures are going to, again, drive transfers from the affiliate, right? So in some sense, all we're saying is these four types of different pressures are going to drive different kinds of transfers. Most of them are going to drive transfers from the affiliate, with market aggregation really being the thing that drives transfers from the parent, for the most part. Yeah.
I might give an interesting example of global knowledge. It would be Boeing and the design of their aircraft. What it is they design them on computers, but they have a 24-hour cycle so that they transfer when it's time to leave or whatever, they transfer to, say, India, which transfers to Europe, so they're designing an airplane 24 hours a day using different knowledge places to do that.
So let me get to the data and talk about what we're actually going to do. So the data all comes from the Bureau of Economic Analysis in Washington, D.C., and the BEA does these surveys. They actually do an annual survey of all U.S. direct investments, so basically all U.S. multinationals. But they have two versions of the survey. There's an annual survey, which is a little bit more, a little bit less detailed. And then every 5 years, they do a much deeper, more detailed survey where they collect a bunch of information that they collect only once every 5 years. The benchmark surveys also have a slightly different sampling criteria, so they just sample a larger percentage of the population, so it's not a consistent sample, which is why we're going to actually focus on the benchmark surveys and we're not going to include the other annual surveys. So we're going to look at one data point every 5 years, just because when we try to combine the benchmark surveys and the annual surveys, you get sort of wide fluctuations between in the years when they switch, and that creates a lot of problems. So it isn't really consistent. So we're just going to use these four, essentially four data points, 1989, 1994, 1999, 2004, for which we have data. And so we're going to construct this four-point panel. As I already mentioned, we're going to focus on majority-owned affiliates only. The reason to pick only majority-owned affiliates and not to the minority is because for minority, they don't collect some of this information. In particular, they don't collect R&D spending, so it kind of makes it hard for us to include them. So we're going to include majority-owned affiliates. The technical definition is anything over 50% ownership, but as I mentioned, most of over 90% are wholly owned and the average ownership is 95%. So you can think of these as, and we've actually run it with only fully owned subsidiaries, and the results are exactly the same. So you can think of them as, entire fully owned subsidiaries. So there are some very cool things about the data, and then there are some drawbacks from using the VA data. So let me talk about those. The benefits, I think what makes this data really valuable and the reason we chose to work with this is, one, it pretty much, for all effective purposes, it covers the population of U.S. multinationals, right? So we're not, the problem with a lot of other work is there's always a question about, what are we really sampling? Are we, we're doing surveys, are we really getting responses from just very large firms? The BEA basically covers pretty much the entire population, so we're very sure that there's no sampling bias built into this. The other big reason is that there's a statutory reporting requirement. So there is an act which requires all firms to report this to the federal government. So which means, one, there's no sort of survey response bias where firms are selectively choosing not to respond. Also, to the extent that you're taking sort of internal reporting of the firm and you want to put any credence to that, especially when you're talking about sort of what were the internal value of internal transfers, we have a little bit more comfortable with that, given that there is, if you're lying on this thing, you're lying to the federal government. So we're a little bit hopeful that this is relatively reliable data. And finally, I think the biggest advantage is that there's really detailed information. So the actual raw BEA data, they're collecting a lot. Things like, in each affiliate, how much do they spend on research and development, what are the wages, how many employees do they have, and frankly, the transfer information, right? I mean, getting information on exactly how much you're transferring from the subsidiary to the parent is not easy. So this is really great detailed data that we're able to work with. The challenges come from the fact that because this data is highly confidential, when you try to take it out of the BEA and do something with it, they impose a lot of constraints. And frankly, those constraints are magnified by the fact that I'm not a US citizen and I don't have security clearance to look at this data, so it's all sort of Heather pulls out the data and then we work with it. And one of the other things we want to do, and I talk about that, is we want to make this data publicly available. So we don't want to be doing an exercise on data that we can't actually share with you, and then there's no replicability because who knows what we did. We want to actually make pretty much all the data we're providing available to other people so they can build on it. But that, again, imposes some restrictions in what we can do. What that means is, one, even though the data is actually collected at the firm level, we are going to be aggregating it up to the industry level. So we're basically going to look at this three-digit industry level. So it's all going to be just added up to the industry level. We're not so worried about that because, obviously, as I said, the construct is at the industry level anyway. So we kind of feel this is the right way to go anyway. But still, there's obviously a lot of heterogeneity within the industry that we're losing. The other problem is that we can't actually take out, even though the data is at the country level, we can't take out individual countries. So we're going to end up doing this thing where we say US, non-US, which means we're now clubbing a whole bunch of the rest of the world together, which is always something of an issue. I mean, I would love to look at this stuff country by country by country, but that's just not possible. Okay. And then finally, because they won't let us take out raw numbers, all of these things have to be ratios. So we're going to be running a whole bunch of analysis predicting ratios as functional ratios. And that has some problems in terms of, although we try to deal with the econometric problems there, but that raises some questions sometimes. So that's going to be our main data source, and I'll talk in a minute about what measures we're going to use. We do have a couple of other data sources that we tap into. So we're going to look at global knowledge in particular using patent data. So we're going to tap into the NBR patent data, which is a whole exercise that people have done, matching patents to firms. So these are all going to be patents filed with the US Patent Office. But then, you know, we're going to use that data to construct sort of these industry-level measures of patenting. The NBR also has manufacturing data, and the data for this comes from the Census of Manufacturing, which gives us some of our controls for kind of, you know, wages that are paid, and so things that we want to control for at the industry level, we're going to draw from the manufacturing data. And finally, Peter Shard at Yale has done a lot of work on international trade, and in particular, he has this wonderful, I mean, I really want to acknowledge, he has this wonderful website where he provides just phenomenal amount of data on international trade, and he's done a lot of work mapping, mapping trade to industries, mapping intermediate and final goods to industries. So we're going to leverage a lot of his work and draw on a lot of his data to kind of supplement, provide some of these controls. So the intermediate versus final goods, we're going to leverage his work to do some of that. Right. So those are going to be the additional data sources, but the main data, I mean, most of it's coming from the VA, and we're supplementing it with some of these other sources for things.
So, Aseem, I never worked with the VA data, but I worked with FTC line of business data, which has got another interesting history like this. And
right.
We'll talk a little bit about citizenship access, and talked about it before. It's really interesting stuff. One of the censoring points for the line of business data is that if there are industries with too few firms in them, so that would give away. Are there any of those issues here that you run into? Are you missing industries because there are only
so two? So what we've done is in a couple of, I think of the 33 industries we have, and I'm trying to remember the exact numbers now, but of the 33 industries we have, I think there were two industries which are actually at the two-digit level. So, you know, we haven't dropped them entirely. We've tried running it by dropping them. It doesn't make a difference. But what we've done is basically said there are too few firms in the three-digit level, but when you aggregate up to the two-digit level, you get enough firms. So they let us take it out. And so I think those industries were, if I remember this right, it was like, I think, sort of furniture and fixed goods or something where there was just very few. And I think grain milling was the other one where there were just too few firms at the individual level. When you aggregate up to the two-digit, so there are sort of two industries which are at the two-digit level and everything else is at the three-digit level. But, you know, we don't have that. The other place where that ends up affecting us is when we start to try to do the affiliate-to-affiliate versus affiliate-to-parent, we run into some trouble there because we can't necessarily take some of that data out. Because, you know, the affiliate-to-affiliate transfers are too small in some of these countries where there's only one or two players.
Right.
And by the way, that's the big reason why the country-level data is not available, right? Because when you start reporting into the country
right.
level, you can't get, there's just too few firms in the industry in that country, which is why we have to do all this aggregation. So you're absolutely right that that's part of what's driving. I mean, the process here is every time even the numbers that I'm going to show you will have to be vetted by the VA before I can actually show them to you. And they do some very actually some very impressive calculations on how you could back calculate stuff from the data they're showing. So it's actually, I'm actually impressed by how much they think we can actually do. But anyway, so here's what we're going to use as measures. We're going to use basically the COVID measure for our dependent variable, except that while Steve is basically combining transfers from parents and transfers from affiliate into a single measure, we're just going to split them up. So the denominator is going to be the same. So you could add our two dependent variables together and get the COVID index, but we're just going to split them into two parts. And as I said, we will try to split them into three as well, but for the main analysis, I'm just going to show you those two. Then the question is, okay, how do we think about our independent variables, right? So market aggregation, we're going to again use pretty much the measure that Steve used, which is parent R&D intensity. So just how, as a proportion of sales, how much do you spend on R&D? And that's kind of a measure of how high-tech you are, and therefore how important market aggregation is for you. For knowledge arbitrage, we're going to use basically the amount of firm R&D that's done in the affiliates, right? So how much of the R&D spending is happening outside the United States is going to be our measure of how important is knowledge arbitrage in this industry. And then I remember I said we need to think about, is knowledge truly global or not? What we're going to do there is we're going to look at the percentage of non-US patents, where non-US patents are defined as patents with inventors outside the United States, right? So number of patents filed with the US Patent Office that had inventors outside the country as a proportion of total patents. That's going to be basically our measure. One challenge there is that patents don't come mapped to industries. So we have to find a way to map the patents to the industry. And we do that using a concordance developed by Brian Silverman in Toronto, which has been used by a number of people. And that basically, he maps the patent classes to the industries. He creates a weight of, for each patent class, what's the weight in the industry. So we can basically construct a measure of, for this industry, what percentage of patents that are relevant to this industry were at non-US inventors. And obviously, the higher that number, the more we're going to say there is a knowledge is global, because there's a lot of foreign innovation that is actually being patented in the US and being used in the US, right? Cost arbitrage, we're going to use our main measure for the results I'm going to show you is basically, we're going to assume that developing countries tend to be lower cost. So the more you've got manufacturing located in developing countries, the more we think there's going to be pressure and costs. And I'll talk a little bit later about what are some alternate measures we've tried. We've looked at import penetration from low-wage countries. We've tried different definitions of what's a developing country. So we played around with that, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. But for the results I'm going to show you, this is going to be the measure. For domestic, for competition, we're going to split it into domestic competition and foreign competition. So domestic competition means competition from US firms in foreign countries. And there we're basically going to create a sort of a Herfindahl index of sales by other firms in your industry. So this is giving you a sense of how concentrated the competition by US firms in that industry in foreign markets is. Now, of course, because we can't split it out by country, we can't actually look at whether you're facing each other in the same country. Which would what ideally you'd want to do. But you know, this is just giving you a sense of how concentrated overall the international competition is overall. Foreign competition, we've tried a bunch of different things. We look at, you know, what's the import penetration into the US by foreign firms. So to what extent are foreign firms imports from foreign firms starting to penetrate into the US market? And we do this using both Peter Schott's data as well as the NBR manufacturing data, combining those two. We've also looked at US exports by foreign firms. So to what extent are foreign firms actually producing in the US and exporting from the US, which is a sign that they're sort of big. I mean, it takes a lot for foreign firms to be that competitive. In the results I'm going to show you, we're going to use patent measures, basically the flip side of our global measure, right? So to what extent are foreign firms coming up with patents that have US inventors? In some sense, are foreign firms truly innovating within the US? And the idea here is that the more firms are able to actually invest in R&D in the United States, that the more they're likely to be sort of important competitors, right? So it's not just about, you know, we've got a lot of sales, but that may just be because we're low-cost players. This is really saying they're not just low-cost players, they're actually important salient competitors because they're driving technology. And the results are pretty much the same across all, I mean, they're pretty much consistent across all these three measures, which makes us feel relatively comfortable about the fact that we're measuring foreign competition, right? We're also going to include a whole bunch of other controls. A couple that I want to highlight, I'm not going to talk about all of them. This issue of, you know, is it finished goods or is it intermediate, we're going to actually include a measure of product intermediation. So Peter Schott's data, basically he goes down to the product level and classifies all products as either intermediate or final. And then he then connects those back to the industry. So he creates a measure of, in every year for every industry, what percentage of goods that were imported or exported were actually intermediate products, right? That's the measure that we're going to use. Now notice that that's a trade measure, so it's not just within firm trade, it's trade across. But you know, we think it's a reasonably good proxy for how much intermediation is happening. And given that the BA doesn't actually track this, it's the closest we can get to trying to control for intermediation. So this is going to be a measure of, in this industry, how much of the imports and exports that we, actually imports that we have, are actually intermediate products. That's the percentage of total imports that are intermediate. The other thing I want to highlight is we're going to have industry fix effects. So it's all going to be within industry, right? We're not looking at the differences between industries. We're going to look at the trend within industries, what's driving the change. We're also going to have period effects. So there's just a sort of overall change in the across industries that's going to be canceled out. And we're going to lag, we're going to use a lag structure. So we're basically going to predict the integration in period P as a function of the all these other variables 5 years ago, right? So there may be concerns about, look, all of these things are being co-determined. We want to sort of use a lag structure to try to get past that. And in using that lag structure, we're also going to include sort of the lag value of this dependent variable to say, you know, is it just, you know, firms that are more integrated tend to be, industries that are more integrated tend to become more integrated, etc. Give me a minute. We've also tried different models, which I'll talk about in a minute. Yeah.
Under global knowledge percent of non-US patents over total patents, how can you differentiate that, say, in a company like IBM, with a non-US patent versus US patent? Because, you know, just list all these patents under IBM.
And the way that works is basically every patent has inventors, and you have the locations of the inventors. So you look at the location of the first inventor, and if the location of the first inventor is outside the US, you classify that as a foreign patent. Again, that's not, I mean,
what if he's residing in the U.S. though, he's a foreigner?
He may be residing in, I mean, so there is some, there's not, it's not perfect, but, you know, it gets you very close to, and, you know, people have sort of looked at, I mean, this is a fairly common measure that a lot of people have looked at, and they're sort of ratified. So I think we're reasonably, okay, so that's, those are going to be, that's how we're going to do it. Let me tell you what the results are. So first, I'm going to focus on transfers from parents. Remember, I said transfers from parents are going to be driven by to what extent is there sort of knowledge intensity. So is there a case for market aggregation? And you can see here the H1 is supported. So R&D intensity positively predicts transfers from parents. So as the R&D intensity of the industry goes up, there tend to be more transfers from parents. We also find support for the home country competition effect. So as home country competition, there's more oligopolistic competition from home country players, you see an increasing role for transfers from parents. And when you control for all the other things, it actually becomes stronger, which is kind of interesting. But to me, the more interesting results are actually transfers from affiliates, because remember, the big thing we said was the big drive change here is affiliate transfers. So when you look at just the affiliate R&D, so how much R&D is being done by the affiliates, you don't see a positive effect. I mean, it's positive, but it's not significant. But when you account for whether knowledge is global or not, you get a result that is consistent with our predictions. So I don't think I actually have the figure here, but in industries where knowledge is global, you see a lot of flows from, you see affiliate transfers being driven by affiliate R&D, which is consistent with this idea of knowledge arbitrage. In industries where knowledge is not global, there is no effect of affiliate R&D, which is consistent with the idea that basically the affiliate R&D is to adapt to local markets, not to kind of spread knowledge globally, right? So again, consistent with our predictions, we're seeing a picture where knowledge is global, you see a lot more affiliate transfers as you start to do more and more R&D in these foreign countries. The other thing that sort of the foreign competition measure, which remember was foreign patenting in the US, again, we find support for that, and as I said, we find similar results with all our other foreign competition measures. I'm not showing them to you here, but they're in the... it's pretty much consistent where you find a significant positive effect. And then very interestingly, the developing country, the cost mechanism, right? So this notion of, you know, sort of prior is, it's all about low cost, but actually, even as developing country, as the amount of manufacturing you do in developing countries increases, that doesn't actually result in an increase in affiliate transfers. So the one thing that doesn't actually hold is the cost arbitrage idea, where you're doing it because you're trying to tap into low cost. Richard?
I have a question, because your SEMCO are looking at within firm. Those are affiliates that are abroad, but owned by the same firm. The reason why they choose to own that subsidiary, maybe there is some asset-specific stuff in there. And if you are tapping the cost, perhaps it is a thick market, there's little assessment. You just outsource it to those guys.
So hold on to that thought, and I talk about that. So actually, let me talk about it now. One of the other things that I'm not actually going to show you in the analysis, but that we've tried and that actually works, mm-hmm. which I'm quite excited about, actually, is we also say, well, maybe this is driving, as you said, it's not driving you to actually set up your own operations. Maybe the cost pressure is driving offshore outsourcing, right? So we then take our offshore outsourcing measure and see whether we can predict offshore outsourcing as a function of the cost pressure.
Okay.
And interestingly, even with this measure, so even with the fact that you're actually setting up a developing country, you do see a positive and significant effect of that.
Right.
And when you combine offshore outsourcing, so you can imagine constructing an offshoring measure which combines affiliate to parent transfers,
mm-hmm.
as well as offshore outsourcing, so purchases by the parent from third parties. When you combine those two into a single measure, you get a much stronger positive effect. So I think what's really going on, consistent with sort of what you're saying, is as the cost pressure increases, what you tend to do is basically find ways to tap into that cost pressure, but a lot of that tapping into the cost pressure happens through outsourcing, not through integration.
Right.
So you're not actually setting up your own units and trying to integrate them, you're just offshoring. So that's certainly the story. But you know, I want you to recognize that that's not what's driving the integration, which is not the story that you know most of us sort of think about when we think about integration, right? So overall, just to sort of summarize, transfers from parents go up with increasing parent firm R&D intensity and increasing foreign competition from home country firms. Transfers from affiliates increase with affiliate R&D in industries with high global knowledge only, and increasing competition from foreign firms, right? So those are the things that are driving. There's no evidence of cost arbitrage driving integration. There is, as I just mentioned, evidence of cost arbitrage driving outsourcing, but that's a different phenomenon. I want to quickly say that I don't want to spend too much time on the robustness checks, but I do want to highlight the cost arbitrage pressures, right? So there's this question about, are you making these investments because there's some asset specificity? So we said, well, we can also think about other things that might drive low cost pressure, right? We could imagine imports from low-wage countries. So forget whether you're doing it or not. There's a lot of import penetration from low-wage countries, where low-wage countries are defined as countries where the average GDP is less than 5% of US GDP. And we've tried different sort of, but that's Peter Schott's definition, so we use that, but we've tried alternate definitions as well. You might imagine that might drive cost pressure, right? There's all this low-wage country imports, no effect. We look at the proportion of production wages, right? So how much of wage is actually going into production? Because the more manufacturing intensive it is, maybe cost pressure is higher. We look at that, we don't find any effect. So, I mean, we've tried a whole bunch of different things to say, look there, because, you know, we started off saying there has to be a cost effect, right? And then we've tried a whole bunch of things and we just don't find it. And then, as I said, what we do find is this offshore outsourcing story, which we think makes sense. So,
the thing is that you go 5% of US GDP, you go in really low cost, but also they're very low skill,
exactly.
Very low infrastructure. So it's like combined of how good they are producing it,
yeah.
Given the cost.
Yeah.
It's not just how.
And again, we've tried doing
cost.
That with developing country imports. So I mean, there's a whole bunch of
yeah,
where you set the bar is kind of open to question. But pretty much no matter what we try, we basically don't see an effect in integration. What we do see is this effect on outsourcing. And so we think that's actually quite, that makes sense, but it's also interesting in terms of just what's going on, right? And then as I mentioned earlier, we do split affiliate transfers into affiliate to affiliate and affiliate to parent and run those models. And what we find is basically pretty much the same results for the two separately. So there doesn't seem to be any systematic differences between affiliate to parent. So the same things that drive the transfers from affiliates increase with the same things, increasing affiliate R&D industries with high global knowledge, and foreign competition drive both of those transfers. So which is why we ended up sort of, we also had some data issues, but we just ended up combining it because we weren't really seeing a different story for those two. It didn't really make too much difference to us to which way we were going. So overall, you know, I think what we're saying is that one, So the Bartlett and Ghoshal's more recent work sort of talks about, makes this distinction between traditional motives and emerging motives, right? The traditional motives are cost and scale, and then the emerging motives are really sort of knowledge and competition, right? That's their sort of typology. And what we're saying is sort of consistent with that story as firms are becoming much more, I mean, again, my personal interest is more in the knowledge-seeking story, as I mentioned earlier. So consistent with that knowledge-seeking story, we're seeing this sort of shift in what's really driving firms to go abroad to cause a change in how we organize and therefore creating this pressure to be more integrated for arbitrage reasons, not for aggregation reasons. So we're seeing an increase overall in kind of the extent of integration driven by increased pressures for knowledge and competitive arbitrage, which we think is important. And then, you know, we want to highlight that this integration in the growing world of subsidiaries is not about cost, which is, I think, a big finding. And as I've already sort of talked about, it seems to be affecting offshore outsourcing a lot more than it's affecting integration, which we think is quite interesting. In terms of implications, I think for the firm, it basically means that this kind of knowledge and competitive arbitrage is driving, you know, there's been a lot of talk about the increasing importance of transnational strategies. I think that's what we're really saying is that's really the driving force behind it. And I talk about that a little bit more. But also, I think from a policy perspective, you know, as we think about what does it mean that, you know, firms are moving production offshore, and there's an increasing sort of location of, you know, this sort of the fragmentation of the supply chain and parts of the supply chain being moved out away. I think a lot of that discussion has been about cost. And what we're suggesting is that that may not really be what's driving firms to go out there. It may be more sort of, partly it may be cost, but partly it may be, you know, knowledge and foreign expertise that firms are trying to tap into. And so as you think about what that means for, one, do we want to be protectionist and do we want to stop that trend from happening? Probably not, because to the extent that we're tapping into expertise and we're dealing with competition, trying to stop firms from doing that might actually be very bad for the economy, because we're just going to make ourselves uncompetitive. But also, it also suggests that in terms of sort of trying to maintain parity of sort of US manufacturing versus some of these other things, it may not really be about cost. It may be about sort of developing expertise and sort of thinking about R&D and thinking about technology, and not just thinking about cost. So again, I think that's interesting in terms of, you know, if we think about the debate about how do we deal with this sort of shift towards offshore manufacturing, at least part of that, certainly the integration part of that really needs to be about foreign technology and expertise and not about cost, which I think has become sort of this dominant. We tend to think about it as all being, oh, people are moving to India and China because, or whatever, Mexico, because it's all cost. And I think we're saying that's not really the big, that's not certainly the last. And I also want to say that, you know, it's possible that some of that has already happened by 1989. I mean, you remember, we're looking at this from 1989 to 2004. So, you know, in that period at least, it doesn't seem to be so much about cost. It seems to be much more about foreign expertise. From a strategy perspective, I just want to sort of emphasize this point about transnationality. So this is the kind of classic integration responsiveness framework, right? So you've got pressures to be responsive, you've got pressures to be integrated, and you end up with these four strategies, depending on how strong the pressures is. What we're suggesting is basically that you need to think about it a little bit differently, in that it's not really about this sort of, you know, unitary integration pressure, unitary responsiveness pressure. It's really, if you take Kemal's typology and apply that, what we're really saying is, if the dominant pressure is aggregation, it's about market seeking, it's about economies of scale, then you want to have this more global model with sort of integration driven by the parent. So more of a hub and spoke picture. If the dominant pressure is adaptation, it's all about, you know, sort of tapping into local markets by, you know, building on local tastes and acquiring local expertise for local reasons, for local purposes, you want to have limited integration, which is sort of the multi-domestic approach, which has always been the story. But interestingly, the transnational approach is really driven by the increasing importance of arbitrage and the fact that you're trying to deal with foreign competitors, you're trying to deal with foreign knowledge that is globally relevant but distributed across different countries. And that might actually drive you to a much more network integration, transnational kind of story. So it's not so much high integration and high responsiveness is driving transnationality. It's really specifically arbitrage, where arbitrage has this, it's partly adaptation because you're tapping into local resources, but partly aggregation because you're trying to use those resources across the country. So we're saying, you know, we may need to think about you know, people have, I mean, Gibamet has certainly talked about aggregation, arbitrage, and adaptation, but we're saying there's an implication of that for how firms configure and how they think about strategy, and that's really the implication. So that's pretty much it. I'm not going to really go through this. This is more sort of, as we put this paper together, we're sort of trying to map out the contributions. I do want to say, though, that, you know, I think one of the, I think the other side of the contribution here is empirical, where there really hasn't been a lot of longitudinal analysis of these trends. So I think we're sort of trying to push that and say, can we think about what's driving the change in these trends rather than just sort of the average differences across industries? And then I think, as I mentioned earlier, we do want to make this data available to other researchers. So, I mean, as I've said, a lot of people have used the COVID index, but they've just taken the COVID index from Steve's paper, which means you're basically putting in a control for 1989 data. And so we're updating those measures, but we're also providing you with a whole lot of other measures, like, you know, what, how global is knowledge in this industry, etc. And we think that actually could be really useful for other researchers. And so that's part of our agenda in terms of putting this together. So that's pretty much all I've got. I'm happy to take questions.
That's great. Thanks very much. One of the things that I would like to pursue with you just for just a moment, it doesn't make a case for protectionism, but, you know, that, and that's, you know, no news in a sense. But I'm curious if there's anything that it suggests otherwise about public policy. Does it suggest any positive action by public policy makers? Maybe not.
I mean, I think it, to the extent that it suggests anything, I think it suggests that we need to think carefully about, and again, this may be just that I am a technology person, so I tend to think, see things through that lens. But I think it suggests that we need to think very carefully about how are we going to be competitive on technology, right? And what do we need to do to ensure that we continue to, I mean, clearly, you know, there is a very strong technological base that we're working off, but we want to think about where are the big next generation innovations coming from. Are those going to be in this country, or are, you know, multinationals going to move to sort of doing a lot of their innovation in other countries, and what does that mean, right? So I think it's really thinking about the technology policy more than sort of the trade or tariff policy.
So it has big implications for education, is obvious, but also for immigration policy.
And immigration policy for education, potentially for sort of government support for, and so there's obviously a whole bunch of work on sort of, you know, government support for innovation and science and research. And I think this suggests that that may be really important as well, right? And particularly as you sort of think about kind of some of the debates we've been seeing in the election and sort of should people go to college.
I take it you think they should.
Yes, I think they should. I think the numbers are suggesting
the way,
they should.
This is a true story. This guy, Santorum, used in an interview yesterday the term inflection point. You know, I mean, that's where the second derivative is, right? Zero. Now, you know, that, where do you learn about stuff like that?
Damn good high
college.
But you said correctly is the question.
Well.
Aseem, could you go back to your matrix previous slide? I think this is an interesting one for me. It helps me to understand the implications really well. It also raises a couple of questions for me.
Mm-hmm.
So let me impose a couple of assumptions. Or you want to make a comment first?
When you said previous slide, is the one just before this?
No, that actually, it's this one, actually. I'll start with, but and the reason I like this is because this is builds off of the Bartlett and Goschal, but also kind of Stoppard and Wells going back to the early 70s. If you really want to go back, they're the guys I talked about. They didn't call it transnational, they called it the matrix. This is the thing. On the x-axis was the percentage of sales abroad, and on the y-axis was the number of products you sold abroad. And that was kind of the way of this organizing this empirically, going back to talking to multinationals. I think it's useful because it gives me a little sense about motivations. It also raises, to me, an interesting question. So whenever I see research on how, on empirical research, where researchers are telling us on how firms organize themselves to do business abroad, at least since 1999 and Miles's paper in Management Science, there's always this issue of sample selection bias. As you're observing the firms that are doing this because they have some pre-existing capabilities that they can only do it that way, and therefore the only way to really know that this is going on is if you compare them to some other control group that hasn't gone abroad or hasn't chosen any of the above. Now, I say that not to just kind of say the usual, you know, there's sample selection, endogeneity.
Yeah.
But because I think with this picture, you have an opportunity to deal with that in advance and maybe to find some interesting, I'll call it next, you know, derivative findings. And here's how. Because the lower left-hand corner is empty. I suspect it's the uninteresting part. That's the part where there's very little integration, there's very little responsiveness. International divisions and firms, that's just the kind of, that's the crazy, that's the skunk works in the back room, where you send your crazy people to run it and they sell whatever's handy left and nobody asks them why or how.
Right.
Okay? So I don't know if you have firms like that in your, or industries like that in your sample, but to the extent that you do, or you could define some that are there because they have, by the Coburn Index, a very low number. So they may sell a lot abroad, but they don't do it through intra-firm transfers. They trade, or they have low sales abroad. Period. But I suspect that you could create like a threshold point on that index, or on some other threshold of foreign sales, so that you could anticipate, you know, the skeptic in the crowd is going to say sample selection, but also so you could do some interesting, I'll call it kind of next derivative, second derivative. You know, analyses,
right?
Where essentially you're saying, my thought is to set up a kind of threshold point, a 0-1 threshold point, a kind of Heckman slug, where the 0-1 is when you get, you've reached some basic level of.
Right. So you're actually doing some integration.
Yes.
Right? You're at least, and we do actually, in the paper, we do have a table, although I think it's going to go away once we get to our page numbers, but we do have a table where we sort of lay out just how integrated some of these industries are. And you're absolutely right that there is kind of this, there's some industries where, I mean, grain mill products is like 5% integration, right?
That's perfect.
It's just not integrated at all. I think I would say the inflection point is probably around maybe, I shouldn't say inflection point, I seeded that in my head.
Threshold.
It's probably, the threshold is probably somewhere around 15-16% where you have like a bunch of firms around that and then there's a bunch of firms around 20% and then there's kind of a gap there. There aren't a whole lot of industries in that lower, I think, but we could certainly do something, and we could certainly look at how those industries differ. So I agree. I think that could be quite interesting.
I think it's not just to anticipate the skeptic. It's actually to get at and sort things. It might be interesting to see how things sort a little differently. I suspect they won't, but how they sort a bit differently. And I think this is also upending the panel structure of your analysis a little bit. But that's okay, right? That's getting at this interesting cross section. And you could do it at different points.
I mean, I think just given sort of the data, I'm not sure that we can do as much to do sort of a first stage prediction model as I think we can just sort of look at the subsample let's just look at the industries that are above that threshold and see how they, you know, is there a difference between those industries and the ones that are sort of just not, integration is not even an issue, and so we don't even, you know, care.
I suspect there's some policy, there's policy research that will provide you with a kind of naturally occurring threshold.
I think
we
can do that.
I think it'd be neat. I like this. This is to me kind of interesting.
Right. I will say though that, I mean, part of the reason we've been hesitant to go too far down this particular picture is because obviously we're not doing firms, right? So there's a whole bunch of sort of firms.
We're not doing firms, right?
So I mean, this is only about firm strategy, and we're doing industry. So I want to be sort of careful. So I mean, this is more sort of, we think, see this more as a sort of discussion and a point for future work than as sort of a main takeaway of what we're doing. But I think it's an important implication as you think about what we're seeing. You wanted me to go to the...
That's what I wanted to see, right. Integration and responsiveness.
So this is like, this is just the standard, you know. Again, this is the stuff that I teach my MBAs. Although I plan to teach my MBAs the other slide as well.
So John Stafford and Lou Wells, was it 1972, based on work they did in 1970, talking to a bunch of U.S. multinational managers, and they just said, tell us about how things work on these two levels.
Yeah.
And here, and they came up with the proxies for this. It's entirely empirically driven.
And I have to admit that I think we've been
taxonomy.
We've been doing it very much sort of based on the Watley and Goshal Pada and those taxonomies.
Just to flip on that, right?
You can do stuff. But it's
a powerful.
The more things change, the more they remain the same, right? So, I mean, I don't know that the taxonomies are changing that much, but
you're
I think
not going to say it all goes back to Ray Brennan. Right?
Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly.
It all goes back to that.
It all goes back to that.
That's exciting.
Other questions?
Two questions, actually. One is, how much does the price of oil, which is affecting transportation costs, affecting transfers?
Well, we don't actually look at that simply because that's all going to be built into the period effects, right? So that's going to affect pretty much all industries, presumably equally. What we do try to do in a, as a robustness check is we include a measure of value by weight. So that's basically, in some ways, that's a measure of how important that transaction cost in this industry. It goes back to beverages, right? So clearly value by weight is very, very low. Now, of course, with firm fixed, with industry fixed effects, that gets knocked out anyway because it doesn't change over time. But we do include that as a measure just to see if that makes any difference, and we find that it doesn't. It doesn't predict integration. I mean, I'm sure it makes a difference, but it doesn't really predict integration. And so we sort of just leave that out in the final analysis. But we do, because people have, and so the other thing that we've done that I'm not showing you here is we also did do the between industry effects, right? So say, you know, all of this is what's happening within the industry, but we can also look at what's actually driving the differences across industries. And if I remember this right, there it does actually make a difference. So sort of in line with your intuition, the higher the transportation costs, the less sort of the, just because it's harder to integrate, right? So you see some effects there. But in terms of how this has changed over time, you don't really see too much of an effect of sort of transportation costs.
Second question is, recently in the last year, I've read a couple articles where there are actually a couple firms now domestically that are bringing, closing up their foreign affiliates and coming back to the U.S., and I'm wondering what's driving that.
Comparative advantage. That's what we undergird everything you pointed out. Whether it's technological acumen or availability of raw materials or labor.
But I will say that actually, so one of the other things that, not with this data, but with a different data set, one of the things that Heather and I are exploring is actually what drives firms to exit from countries. Mm-hmm. And so what we're looking at is not just, and I think the results are consistent with in saying what we show is basically that you're more likely to exit a country if you have both weak technological capabilities yourself, or if your technology capabilities are, so if you're not managing to compete technologically, you want to get out of these countries and sort of focus on your core technology in your home country. But also you're much more likely to exit countries where over time the fit between the technology in the country and the technology, so again we can use patent data to look at, you know, is the technology in the country related to your technology? And as that sort of fit declines, you see people leaving, right? Just because it's not just advantage, it's also, okay, you know, this country has a bunch of technology, but the things that are becoming hot in this country are not the things that we really work on. Or maybe we're moving away from our old industries, and so we're moving out of those countries. So a lot of it is just sort of, you know, what's happening. And obviously, it's not the only explanation, but a lot of it is sort of what's happening in the technology space.
Well, I see we want to thank you. This was a terrific and stimulating. Thanks for sharing.
Thank you for having me.